You! Get your hand out of your pants.
Please put your tray table up. Put the crack pipe down.
You're the least without sin person I know.
Errol, we are on the air right now.
Bro, I was digging for gold.
That's what's eating Gilbert Grape, my friends.
Well, listen, call me casual, but I love to take my time.
I don't know where your head ends and this weird turtleneck sweater begins.
Speaking of which, whatever happened to that porn star you were dating?
Oh my God, it's huge.
And now,
it's West
by Midwest.
Wow, check out the new intro, huh?
New intro, ladies and gentlemen.
Wow, that was nice. Nice job, Rob. Wondering what you do every week.
Hey, everybody. My name's Errol Gribble.
And I'm Chuck Anchoy. Errol's broadcasting live from Lansing, Michigan.
Chuck's broadcasting live from Los Angeles, California. And we've got our producer, air quotes, producer, Robert Hubbard, joining us from Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Good evening. This is Kimye West by Northwest, huh? This is
welcome to Kimye West by Northwest. No, this is West by Midwest, not to be confused with Kanye West's baby.
Yeah, this is episode 22. It's June 24th, 2013, Monday night. What's up, guys?
It's another lovely Monday night in Michigan. I got nothing. It's boring out here.
It's hot, though, right? You guys are experiencing some very sweltering kind of weather.
Yeah, it's, you know, what is this, the third day of summer, second or third day? And since the first day of summer, we actually got the heat going.
Yeah.
Heat wave!
What, like 80, high 80s or what?
I believe that is correct, yeah. I think we might have broken 90 at some point.
Holy
We had some thunderstorms roll through.
And the thunder rolls.
I don't know what that is.
And the jelly rolls. those are horrible jokes that are gonna get edited out. That's what those are.
And we don't have rain or storms here, so I'm not sure.
No, y'all got dust.
We got smog.
Yeah. I'm currently working on, speaking of dust and smog, I'm working on my show.
How's that coming along?
Good. We just finished our first week of rehearsals for Tuna Does Vegas at the Williamson Theater, and I'm working on all my Texas accent and all my Lady Texas voices.
Is that a character?
I don't know. They've all blurred together. Huh. But there's new characters. America. That's another Texas accent for you. There's one new character. They go to Vegas, right? So there's a bunch of new Vegas characters. And one of them, you'll love, Chuck. She's an acupuncturist. Her name is Wohu.
What? Rohu?
Wohu.
What does Rohu sound like?
It's Wohu.
Brohu.
Not Ro. What? Not like fish. Who cares? Give her a call or whatever the hell you want. But she a very Asian stereotype. Come in and she like, oh, you're a real big girl. We need extra needle for you.
Wow. Coming to the show, all right?
Come on. She's inspired by you.
By me?
Yeah, I was like, yeah. I'm going to channel my inner Charles Ganchori.
What are you talking about? I'm the whitest Asian person you know.
Seriously, you'd redefine what a Twinkie is. Yellow on the outside.
White on the inside. Listen though, you had a good idea though. Errol,
I did.
If listeners are out there, I mean, Errol should be cited as the founder of this, but if someone can create a smartphone app that'll run lines with actors, I think you really have a good idea there.
I posted a comment about Facebook because I was trying to memorize lines today because I'm behind and I've had 2 days off and there's no reason I shouldn't go into rehearsal tomorrow off book. And I
Star Trek TNG.
Netflix 12 hours later. That's my life. That's what I've been doing. So I posted about I wish somebody would come up with an app. And those apps actually do exist where you can run lines.
Oh, so you did? You looked it up, and there were ones.
I did. There's different ones. You can pay for some to like. You can pay to put your script up there for some of them. Some are better than others. Obviously, the best ones are iPhone apps, which I can't use. Thanks. Another reason. Like, we should start a scoreboard. Like Chuck Errol versus like Android versus iPhone.
Right, right.
I'm way behind. Like,
that's right.
I'm still like, I can. You know what? I can hack mine. Can you hack yours? I broke mine. You can't break yours. That's it. But the problem is they're all the apps are. It's like more work than actually just grabbing your script and memorizing.
Right.
It's like, hey, you can upload this and highlight your lines, and then I'm like, yeah, you know what? That's done. Or
yeah.
They're like, you can record all your lines and then only play back the other person's side. And
no.
No.
I'm not going to record all the lines.
I want an app that does all of my work for me.
Including like, memorizing my lines for me.
For me, right. Oh, well. What about you? This has been a big week for you, man.
No. Bad Porn, my web series, finally premiered on YouTube.
Oh, congratulations.
Last Friday. So, yeah, you should... check out that. Go to YouTube, search out Bad Porn.
There's a lot of swearing.
It is not safe for life, my friends.
No.
It's funny.
I really thought all the jokes were going to be about like this shy, awkward Asian kid who just stumbles into porn on accident. And it's not. It's like this really crass, angry little potty mouth Asian who's like, yeah, man, I fucking did porn, so suck my dick, bitches. Like, it's just, but it's really funny. Don't get me wrong. It's very funny, and Chuck's very good in it, so you should check it out.
Oh,
and it's
yeah.
short, so if you think it's not good, just wait 30 seconds. It's done.
It's done, yeah. And so it'll premiere every Friday. A new episode will premiere on YouTube, so subscribe to Bad Porn, and you can check out me naked at some point during the season.
Oh yeah, I can't.
Yeah, there's
wait.
There's a little bit of simulated nudity. I'm not gonna lie.
Oh, there's already been a little. You pull your pants down. You have to. Like,
oh yeah, that's right. That's right. Well then, I guess simulated.
That's axe. Check out the snake. He says.
Spoiler. So yeah, that's pretty cool. I'm you guys should. There's also a web series called Bloomers. That. Is on YouTube as well. It's about like 20-somethings. You know, I'm trying to make it in LA, that whole song and dance that we're all familiar with. And they actually, every week on Wednesdays when they premiere a new episode, they have a live talkback episode the same evening, and I'll be hosting that. So if you guys want to go to, it's going to be a Google Plus Hangout as well. We'll post the link on our Facebook page. But yeah, Bloomers Live Wednesday night. I'll be hosting that, and you can check me out there.
Chuck and Shory hosting. You also get to play the new millionaire game, right? Like
Million Second Trivia or something? I don't know. It's an NBC trivia game that this job I got through stand-in work for Nickelodeon. I got
when Chuck stands in for real children.
For 10-year-olds.
I meant to ask you, when you do the Nickelodeon stand-in work, do you ever work with little people? Like 50-year-old dwarves?
Not dwarves. It's always just, no dwarves or little people. It's all just really short adults myself.
All right, so they don't need like really little. They just need just short men.
Right, and women.
Petite men and women.
Petite men and women, yeah. So we... yeah, so we'll come in and we're all like, hey, we're all short. What's going on?
That'd be a great place to hook up.
Yeah, I should. I do like shorter chicks. Million Second Quiz is the name of the NBC game show that we are doing. We're actually going to be playing. We're doing a run through of it tomorrow for camera and electronics.
Yeah, so Chuck's not actually going to be on the show.
No.
He's just there doing blocking for the camera and for lighting, yeah?
Lighting, yeah, camera, and yeah, the electronics and stuff like.
But
like
you do actually get to play the game.
Yeah, we'll get a plunger and we'll get the ring in, Rob.
It's called a plunger, the thing you use to ring in.
On a game show.
We had an argument on a couple episodes ago. Nobody believed Errol when he used the word plunger.
I'm a skeptic.
What'd you say?
He's still a skeptic about it, but
thanks for that.
I'll tell you. I'll report back and make sure that we know. You know, so what? Yeah, that's,
you call Alex Trebek and tell him you're a skeptic.
Suck it, Trebek.
So's your mother. So Paula Deen fired Food Network.
Wow. Yeah. Racist.
Right?
Unbelievable. Paula Deen.
The Food Network said Friday it's dumping Paula Deen. Hey, y'all. How about some booter and all? It was barely an hour after she posted her two videotape apologies begging forgiveness for the racial slurs she had done in the past.
Yeah, wow.
In the past.
I can't believe her. You know, I look up to Paula Deen.
You look up to Paula Deen?
I look up to her recipes.
You look up her recipes. That's not the same thing.
I love butter. I hate butter now.
Yeah, honestly, I thought that's why. Like, I would assume at some point she was going to get kicked off the Food Network because so many people died from eating her food. Like, that's what I thought. I'd be like, 1,700 heart attacks later, Paula Deen kicked off Food Network.
Fired for killing thousands of people.
Yeah, because, I mean, is it really a surprise that a 60-some-year-old woman from Georgia is racist?
No, that's not a surprise. However, right. You know...
She is a public personality. She needs to, but she dumb, man. All that booter is cogging up her brain cells, apparently.
I feel like she just kind of said the comments like as an aside, and then it just all blew up in her face. Mea culpa. Right.
So, the court documents filed this week revealed that under questioning, she said that she had used the N-word. She said, yes, of course. Though it's been a very long time. And that's sort of what got her into all the trouble. But it started with one of her employees, right?
Yeah, one of the assistants or whatever.
Yeah. Miss Jackson, if you're nasty.
Sorry, Miss Jackson.
Sorry, Miss Jackson.
While I was looking it up, we're trying to, like, kind of vamp.
Lisa Jackson.
Lisa Jackson. All right.
The ex-employee Lisa Jackson said she was sexually harassed and she worked in a hostile environment rife with innuendo and racial slurs.
Wow, sounds like Mel Gibson's office.
Seriously, it's like working for Gibson. It's being a Jewish kid in Hollywood trying to work for Mel. Oh, man. Yeah, it's funny, though. Not only did she apparently admit to saying... she said that she went to a restaurant, her and her brother Bubba went to this restaurant, and they and there was a bunch of African American folks dressed in white, and they were like, it was like this racism themed restaurant, and they were like, ooh, that's a great idea for our wedding. So they were going to plan a family wedding that way.
Wow.
And they decided to back out right at the last minute.
Two racists walk into a restaurant.
You know what'd be great for the wedding? What if we had a slavery theme? What if we had a bunch of niggers come in here? Chuck and I decided beforehand to use the word ninja
for the show
instead of the other N word. Be like, hey y'all, welcome to Paula Deen's cooking for niggers. Nothing tastes better than biscuits built by niggers.
God, if she had just used ninja, this whole thing would have been a brand new venture for her. She would have been making millions.
That's not true. People would still be dying from eating too much Paula Deen food. It's not less offensive. You're still... Oh, and what bothers me is that she came out and she apologized, but she apologized by saying... Basically, like, well, I'm colorblind. It doesn't matter to me what color you are or what religion you have. And it's like, you know what? That should matter. You should care about someone else's background and personal history, and you should respect their differences. We should embrace our differences here, people.
Yeah, you can't just
erase our differences, y'all.
You can't just say whatever you want, racist. When you're racist...
When you're racist, you're racist. I don't care, matter how good your pies are.
Exactly. Well, Paula Dean, you know, we've got a job for you here at West by Midwest if you want to be a staff cook.
We hate old white women, so we're going to be racist towards you. So get ready for that. But your cooking's awesome. Big week in Michigan.
Yeah, a lot of weird stories coming out of Michigan this week.
A lot of weird stories in Michigan. A lot of this I got from, I'm going to give a plug, even though they haven't come on our show, bunch of bastards. one of my favorite blogs, it's called Dam Arbor, and it's friends of ours have a blog in Ann Arbor, and they give the little goings-on. And a man was arrested for masturbating while riding his bike through the Diag. At University of Michigan. The Diag is sort of a diagonal big area. I mean, most universities have a Diag, right?
I don't think Eastern had a Diag.
Eastern didn't have a library.
We didn't have anything over there. We had a big penis tower, and that was it.
That was it. A bunch of places where you could puke after you got drunk. That was it. But, you know, it's like a big open quad area square.
Sure.
You know.
Yeah.
So, University of Michigan police arrested a man who was masturbating while riding his bike through the Diag Monday evening, which is the second arrest for public masturbation in 2 days.
Whoa.
Yeah. Just
nice.
People. Public. You know, they're cool with the marijuana out there, so apparently dudes get high and jerk it out.
Right. I mean, like, it's, you know, if it was a college student, like a college freshman, or maybe a student that was, like, being hazed for fraternity or whatnot, I would understand, but this was a 46-year-old man, wasn't it?
Yes, the 46-year-old man reportedly was riding his bicycle with his shorts down and fondling himself, according to police. That's talent. You know what?
Like, yeah, that is, I mean, it's hard enough for me to ride a bike.
Right, it's hard enough for me to masturbate.
I'm trying to switch gears at the same time. I'm trying to switch my own gear.
His pants are down. And he's, like, trying to pedal, and he's like, man, good for you, pal. Good for you, creepy middle-aged man.
So the other guy for public masturbation was probably just walking down the street, and this guy
saw him and got the idea.
Definitely one-upped him. He's like,
check out that guy jerking off. Guess what? I'm going to do it while I'm riding my bike.
Beat that. And this.
You lazy. Oh, well.
Yeah, well, craziness isn't only at U of M, ladies and gentlemen. There's some craziness happening at Robert and I's alma mater, Eastern Michigan University, just skipped down the street in Ypsilanti, Michigan. Police say that a man high on hallucinogenic mushrooms ripped off part of his own penis at Ypsilanti High School.
Oh, my God. what? There's so many things wrong with this story.
A 41-year-old man from Columbus, Ohio, is recovering after police say he ripped off part of his penis while high on hallucinogenic mushrooms. Police say that when they questioned the man, he said he was in town visiting friends and he had picked up mushrooms earlier in the day.
Well, thank God he wasn't local. Like, us Michiganders, we know how to handle our mushrooms.
Do you?
No.
I went to college with Rob Hubbard.
Did he ever rip off a part of his penis?
Maybe a little. Maybe.
He did chafe it. It's because he uses socks to masturbate.
Furiously masturbate with a sock.
With a sock? Who does
on
that?
On mushrooms.
On mushrooms?
For 6 hours. We're talking about Rob Hubbard in Ypsilanti, Michigan, ripped off part of his penis, ladies and gentlemen.
Rob, was this you? Did you lie about your age and say you were 41 and from Columbus?
To throw off the scent.
I would never claim being from Columbus.
but he does.
He can corroborate the rest of the story.
Right. Yeah, the rest of that makes total sense to him.
It's crazy, though, because it's like, you know, this... I feel like, you know, Rob, you and I, we did some mushrooms in our day, and like this is a story that, I'm not surprised by it. You know, I'm surprised a little bit by the like
no,
ripping
I
off
am.
His penis.
Yeah, why are you not I surprised am. By a man ripping off his penis? Mushrooms are laid back; they're chill. You know.
No, dude, you have that bad trip, man. It's a mess. The next thing you know, you're talking to your shower curtain and ripping off your penis.
Oh, my God. Please don't ever do shrooms again. Did you ever have a bad trip on shrooms?
I actually have not had a bad trip on mushrooms, luckily.
Rob Hubbard, bad trip on shrooms?
No.
See? Always in it. Yeah, always
all natural. Remember the kid we met in Colorado who tried to sell us the shrooms, Mingus?
At the bus stop, yeah.
At Mingus. The bus stop. Hey, man, you guys want... And those shrooms look good. I still regret not buying them from him.
I know. We're in Colorado. We should have...
Yeah, well. I mean, he was sketched out as a little weird white-haired hippie named Mingus.
Yeah.
But, shrooms stall. I could imagine somebody, like, you know, dropping acid and ripping off his penis.
But acid isn't so much of a hallucinogenic. It's more, I mean...
Yeah, but sure you can freak out on acid.
Yes. Yeah.
In fact, it probably was acid, and he told the cops mushrooms to kind of save some face.
Why would you say... That doesn't...
That's what you told the cops, Rob?
Rob, is that what you told the cops?
You said it was mushrooms, and you actually
told them it was... Right.
Rob, that didn't help your case at all. You know what, though? We're ignoring this, the most disturbing part of the story. The fact that it happened at Ypsilanti High School.
Right. He was found...
Was it at the high school? But it was a school, right? It was like...
What time of day?
Who cares? Why?
Well, it was the school full of high school kids, or
no? Ooh, that makes yeah. That's a good point. Was it noon at lunchtime?
Recess? The story didn't actually have a lot of the like pertinent details.
It did. Chuck just didn't read them.
No, I swear to God, look at the article. It's very, very short. Just like this man's new penis.
Oh.
All right, folks, so we're gonna continue talking about penises all show?
I really just want to talk about this guy's penis the whole show. You know what? Don't be afraid to do mushrooms. You're not going to rip off your penis. Just because Rob did doesn't mean you're going to. So I found online a map. It's actually another thing I got from Dan Arbor. It's the literal meanings of places in the U.S. mapped. So you can go on there and see what your city actually means.
Okay, what'd you find out?
Well, so it's easy to think of words such as California or Texas or New York as just the places on the map, but those words, like I said, actually meant something once, and they offer a little glimpse into history. The map was designed by cartographers Stefan Horms and Silke Pust. They label the state, cities, and landmarks with the literal meanings of their official names. Now, obviously, we've talked about this before. The reason why I thought it was cool is we talk about it all the time, Milwaukee, Milwaukee, the good land. The good land.
It's Algonquin.
Algonquin for the good land. So, yeah, and a lot of them are like that. A lot of Michigan is the land of the big lakes. Mississippi is land of the Great River, but some of them are a little crazier. Like Alabama is the land of the thicket clearers.
Thicket clearers,
yes.
The edge of your land had like a heavy thicket of grass, or
yes, some growth and underbrush that you needed to clear. Missouri is land of the people with dugout canoes.
Dugout canoes.
Yeah, Mexico means navel of the moon.
Yikes. Bunch of lint.
Yikes. Cuba is the place to find gold.
Well.
So head on down to Cuba, folks.
Yeah.
And my favorite, and this is a shout out to the guests that we're going to have later. Chicago apparently means stink onions.
Now that makes sense.
Why does that make sense?
It does make sense because of their Polish sausage and all their stinky sausages and all that shit.
And they grill onions and throw it on their dogs and whatnot, right?
Yeah.
Stink onions.
Every city has hot dog vendors that grill onions. You can't. It should be like, isn't it like the Windy? It's known as the Windy City. How did it end up being stink onions?
Because they make stinky onions and put right, them on hot dogs.
They're passing wind over there. It's stinky onion wind.
We'll ask our guest who's from Chicago when he comes in. We'll get, because for some reason I don't trust Rob Hubbard's expert opinion.
Wait, Chuck and I are in agreement here.
Right? I'm in agreement on this. I figured that, yeah, like Rob said, you know, like kind of like how Dodger dogs are big here, I would say that like Chicago's got, but you know Abe Froman, the sausage king of Chicago. he likes to toss onions on his.
Oh, man. There you go. But yeah, so check out the, it's slate.com. And you can check out the crazy map because it's good stuff.
What's up? Is Los Angeles Lost Angels or what are the Angels or what is?
It's actually not. It means the messengers. So the city of angels. Angels are messengers. So it means the messengers.
All right.
Yeah.
What about San Diego? Is that a whale's vagina?
It is not. I believe San Diego is actually called
San Diego.
Close to the San Diego. No, I don't even know where it is. I think it's called Saint Heel Holder.
Heel Holder? Like the heel of my foot?
Yeah.
Get off
of
me.
Actually, Chuck, you might have to double check that because the hardest part is that it doesn't have the actual name of the city. So you have to know where your city is.
Oh, okay. All
right. Right? So like
you're looking for San Diego. You're actually at Tijuana.
Right. I'm deep into Mexico,
which the literal term is donkey show.
there's a place in Oregon that's called I've Found It.
Oregon?
Oregon?
Oregon? Wait, where? Portland? That's called I Found It?
I think so. I think Portland literally means I found it. I'm not kidding. And then what's funny is, where is it? Oh, no, maybe that's not in Oregon. Man, see, I don't even know. I'm still in California. What? That's like somewhere, that's North California somewhere. It's I found it. There's some city.
Weird.
Portland is actually called Portland. Like that's its name. That's what it means.
It's a port.
Although there is
there's
a city in beautiful land, which is what Oregon means.
Oregon.
And it's called Realm of the God of the Underworld.
Realm of the God of the Underworld. That's pretty
crazy. Yeah, yeah. But it's funny because Washington, the state, means marsh farmland.
I mean, that could make sense. The literal word for Washington is marsh farmland.
Marshington. Washington.
What is the literal name for Walla Walla, Washington?
I can't find it. Let's move on. scientists say plants are good at math.
What?
Yeah, scientists at Britain's Jean Inn Center said plants do complex arithmetic calculations. Let me try that again. Do complex arithmetic calculations to adjust their rate of starch consumption to prevent starvation during the night when they are unable to feed themselves with energy from the sun.
This is crazy. People, I heard this the other day, maybe a couple weeks ago, too, that, plants feel when they,
Oh, yeah.
These are living beings.
Yeah, scientists have shown that plants respond to pain. Plants will respond to music. They grow better with, classical music playing versus, Led Zeppelin.
Right, and,
That's not true.
It is true.
No, it's not. My plants appreciate Led Zeppelin.
No, to be fair, they used hard rock or / classic rock in the study. They didn't use Zeppelin, but I'm just gonna make Rob angry. Rob, you should do a study and do Led Zeppelin versus Bach and see what your plants grow better on. But you have to actually take care of your plants though, so.
Now, how? Go ahead, Rob.
Well, there's such a wide range. I would, give them some softer Zeppelin for most of the day.
You wouldn't throw some cashmere right at them, or you wouldn't.
No, I'd start with some
Black Dog.
More, maybe even Stairway.
Stairway, yeah, they'll like that.
Yeah, give them some Brahm YR.
We just lost half our audience.
Not the Les Zeppelin fans.
Not the Les Zeppelin fans.
Now, how do scientists know that they can do complex arithmetic calculations?
Well, I what am I, a scientist? I don't know. They do. Based on like the signals and stuff that they're getting, like when they microscopically check their leaves and shit, they're like, oh, they have to do. It's. I mean, it's the same basic principle as us with our internal clock.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
How like we, but I mean.
But this isn't like intelligence. Like these guys. These
oh yeah, no, they're gonna take over. It's like. Yeah. It's like World War Z, but with plants.
World War Z.
World War Z. For all you Canadians listening.
For our Canadian audience, World War Z. So it's not like, what was that M. Night Shyamalan movie where the trees were killing people? Mark Wahlberg. Like, that's what I'm worried about.
I don't
know
what you're talking about.
Oh, I just spoiled this film, didn't I? There's a M. Night Shyamalan movie with Mark Wahlberg where... I guess the twist was that the trees were killing people. But they didn't base that on, you know, this article or plants being able to do complex arithmetic calculations. Sam Hubbard will know what I'm talking about, all right?
No. It just makes me angry that plants are smarter than me.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
I couldn't get past my functions class senior year in high school. Can this Venus flytrap beat me out?
Seriously, he's doing, like, calculus? Not only that... They know, like, when to feed themselves. They're like, I have this much food. I gotta ration it out. Right?
Chlorophyll? More like borophyll.
I can't ration my food intake out. No. Right? You put a month's worth of food in front of me, it's gone in a day.
Gone in 30 minutes.
30 minutes.
Gone in 60 seconds, we should say.
That's our jokes are awful tonight.
We are just referencing the worst movies ever on this.
Rob, do we have anybody listening on Google Plus Hangouts? Your microphone's off.
Ow!
I apologize. Yes, we do.
Who's hanging?
I don't know. They haven't voiced themselves, but I see we have a couple of viewers.
So shout out to if you're hanging out on Google Plus Hangouts, shout out because we're. We're bombing tonight.
Thank you so much for listening, guys. Thanks.
Yeah, so please feel free to chime in with any horrible movie references you want to.
Oh, we just lost a viewer.
Oh!
That is what we do.
Oh, boy.
That's how we do. So, yeah, speaking of helping us out, why don't we bring on our guest?
Yeah, we couldn't do any worse.
It can't get any worse, folks.
Wait, hey, Errol, Sam, was he knew The Happening. You don't remember The Happening? The Happening by...
Mark Wahlberg and Zooey Deschanel starring in The Happening.
Oh, Zooey Deschanel.
M. Night Shyamalan's, that's where the plants and the trees made... What was it?
Sam, they release this something. There's a toxin where they release into the air that... forces humanity to kill itself. Individual acts. So you see a man start a lawnmower, lay down, and let it roll all over him. You know, breaking news of a man jumping into a lion cage. It was.
And it's ridiculous. Caused by the plants.
It's caused by the plants, and watching Mark Wahlberg string it all together is priceless, is what it is.
Come on, come on. Feel it, feel it.
I feel like the plants are what's doing it.
Feel the vibrations.
Hell yeah, dude. Funky bunch.
Feel the plants killing me. Alright, are we ready?
Oh, okay, yeah. I did not realize we were already... I thought we were already doing part two.
Nope.
Go!
Alright, so, ladies and gentlemen, we want to welcome this week's guest, the multi-talented, ever-popular, adorable-faced... Samuel Jackson Hubbard.
Sam Hubbard. Sam, what's your middle name?
Benjamin.
Samuel Benjamin.
Benjamin Hubbard. After your father, Benjamin.
After my father, because...
And your grandfather.
Right. Well, they were both Benjamin Woodrow Wilson Hubbard, and because there were two of me
your
when I was
Samuel
born.
Grover Cleveland.
Yeah, well, they couldn't give the full name to one of the twins, you know.
Samuel Spiro Agnew Hubbard.
He's not a president even. What are you doing? So to explain, Sam is an actor. He's he's also a fight choreographer, and I'm sure you do lots of other stuff. But we know Sam. He's Rob's cousin. And we actually helped raise this little youngin.
I don't know. I mean, that might be overstating it a little bit.
We helped keep him from growing up at times, I think.
You taught me a few words, you know.
that's awesome. So, yeah, Sam's a twin. Your twin brother, Eric. Mm-hmm. We're going to have him on the show soon.
Good choice.
Yeah, Eric's the cooler of the two twins.
Yeah. Blonde, shy, quiet, very nice. Funnier. Professional athlete.
He's on a team in Detroit, right?
The Detroit Mechanics.
Yes.
Michigan's ultimate frisbee professional affiliate.
Professional ultimate frisbee player. How does that make you feel?
Yeah. What's it like having a brother that overshadows you?
You know, it's been a lifelong journey. So it's,
yeah,
it's,
I mean,
he doesn't feel any different.
He's just genuinely better.
It's just when people legitimately, without an ounce of irony, call you the evil twin.
Wow. So he must be getting a bunch of ladies and just signing autographs.
He's superior in many qualities. However, there are a few that I.
Ooh, there it is, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, calling him back. Coming out fighting.
Say it right there. Say it over.
No, it's funny because I actually I went to Rob's son's first birthday party over the weekend, and I saw your dad and your brother and your aunt, Sue, and that was her joke. She was like, you should just talk about Eric the whole time Sam's on. And he'll feel right at home.
It'll be like nothing's ever changed. Well, I would tell him.
No.
I would always tell my mom, you know, Eric's the favorite. We talk about Eric being the favorite. She'd say, no, honey, Zach is the favorite.
Oh, yeah.
She knows where to put him.
Yeah. That's awesome. Aunt Marcia. Spitfire.
So, Sam Hubbard, you are living in Chicago, yeah?
That's correct. The city is still standing as of right now.
Congratulations. Congratulations on the Blackhawks.
I have no... Yeah, that's the thing. I know people from Michigan who move to Chicago and they become Cubs, Blackhawks, Bears fans, and I don't get it. I'm a loyal...
He's wearing the old English D.
He's repping the D.
Quote, the old English D, like George Clooney on a red carpet. It's
there you go.
Classic.
Yeah, you're not that. It's not that far from Detroit either, so I don't understand.
A lot of Michiganian ganders out here.
They convert.
They assimilate.
Well, it's the closest big city that isn't Detroit. So
why are they a bunch of traitors?
Yeah, you know, but I don't understand why they change the sports teams. That doesn't make any sense to me.
Fair weather fans.
You're telling me, man. So we'll see if the city is still standing.
You like Chicago, though. You like living there?
Yeah, you like Chicago?
Love it. Love it. There's a beach in a city. What more can you ask for?
So actually, Chuck and I met Sam not only at awkward family functions that we were crashing, but through the Young Actors Guild.
Fun Actors Guild. Van Arbor.
Actors Guild. A children's theater group that we helped corrupt when we were... straight out of college, basically. And so tell us what you've been doing since then.
Since then, I went to school out here in the fair city of Chicago at Columbia College.
Nice.
Yeah, it's great.
Columbia?
Exactly. You can tell people going to Columbia, and they congratulate you on the Ivy League. And you just nod and say it's
nod
very
and
nice.
Smile. Nod.
Thank you very much.
I appreciate it. And I've been working as an actor and freelance fight director in the city for... companies large and small, and teaching people how to punch each other without really punching each other, and living the dream every
living
day.
Living the dream.
Did you?
Oh, that's awesome.
I don't even know if you remember, but your first fight lesson was from me.
I believe it. No way.
Yeah. Yeah.
With you and Mr. James Fraunfelter?
No. I'm sure it was before that. It was before. It was during one of Rob's shows that he was directing. He had me come in and do some fight choreography. So when you were like a baby.
I was playing Bob the Sheep, probably.
One of his finest roles.
It's still listed on my resume. It's
not. You had to punch out Scott Mooney for the role, or what happened on that one?
I don't remember. I was a sheep. He was a kid. We went to another dimension full of space pandas.
Space pandas.
Yeah.
Rob Hubbard?
Wow. That was a David Mamet piece.
Yeah, it was. my introduction to Mammoth.
There it is. His finest work.
Yeah. They get, yeah.
Wait, does Scott Mooney live here in Los Angeles now,
Scott
or what?
Mooney lives in Los Angeles. You should
look this kid up. Anyway, what are you doing? Show's not about him.
You're playing Stanley in Brighton Beach Memoirs, yeah?
Stanley Jerome in Brighton Beach Memoirs at Raven
Theater.
That's
a pretty great role, my friend.
Nice, it is. Nice job.
Thanks. Very, very lucky to have it with the company that's doing American Classics for 30 years here in Chicago. So their storefront has been around. We've had a long run, and we've still got 3 more weekends.
How long's the run?
We previewed end of April. We run until July 14th.
Wow, okay. That is a long run. Jeez.
Yes.
Now,
are
you getting your equity points for this show?
No, this is one of the longer-standing non-equity theaters.
But you're getting money. You're getting paid.
I'm getting some money, and we extended it, which makes more money. So
yes. Yeah.
You need that.
At the Raven, Raven Theater, is that the name of the company as well?
Yeah, the Raven Theater, located on Clark and Granville.
Very cool.
Check them out. Check out Sam Hubbard playing Stanley. Do you...
Are you working on another show right now as a violence designer?
No. Uncle Bob at Mariachi Theater Company, another long-standing non-equity standby here... opened up a couple weeks ago. It's by Austin Pendleton, and there's a fight at the climax of the piece that I put together for them. So,
nice job.
Yeah, you know, I'm
beaming right now. I can't tell you how proud
this guy.
I am.
Yeah,
this little kid.
Watch this kid.
Seriously, and I can tell. I'm sure you have gotten rid of your stutter. We used to call it the Sam stutter.
I just would be thinking so fast that my mouth
wasn't catching
up.
It was the most adorable thing I'd ever seen, because it wasn't like a stutter, like literally, your brain would just stop. You'd be like, in the middle of a sentence, in the middle of a word, Sam would just stop up.
Because what I want to tell you is,
I'd loved it. Oh, man.
But Sam, I heard a rumor that you were offered... a job in Los Angeles, and you passed on that, or what?
Last summer I took on a 2-person vaudeville sword fighting show at the Bristol Renaissance Fair. Mm-hmm. I took a for my mentor.
Renaissance Fair.
Yeah, you get stuck in it. I took over for my mentor David Woolley, who's been doing the show for 26 years with his partner.
That's cool.
And there was talks of moving that show also to the Southern California Renaissance Fair.
Cool.
SoCal.
It conflicted with some of my more traditional theater interests here, but we're talking about perhaps moving it in down to Southern California for 2014, April.
All right.
We'll be hopefully out there amongst the stars.
You know, everyone that's
So see, I was
making the
dreams
happen.
I had all this pride. I was like, "Way to go, Sam! Hold strong to your roots. You stay in the Midwest. You work like an actor, like a real goddamn
actor."
He's selling out the first chance he gets. Yeah.
No, you come out here. You join the Scientology crew, and you get into the cocaine with us.
You're gonna be doing porn in 2 years with Chuck.
Bad porn, right?
Bad porn. Please don't.
Really?
Come on.
Bad porn.
I could not have less interest in moving to Los Angeles.
Oh,
wow. Good for you, my friend. Good for
you. Midwestern American theater.
There's a lot of amazing, wonderful theater that happens in the Midwest. The folks just, you don't know about it if you don't live in that city.
Well, the Tonys, Tracy Letts, Pam McKinnon, all Chicagoans who directly thanked Chicago Theater. It's a real place down here.
There was another shout-out. Somebody shouted out to regional theater across the country.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which every jerk-off in my state freaked out about.
We've got 3 regional, maybe 3 or 4 regional Tony winners here in Chicago. So
nice.
Very cool.
That's awesome. Yeah, I noticed this year and many years they give it to like a regional theater on the East Coast. And I'm like, come on, could you spread the love just a little farther west, please?
Well, you know the Tonys. It's a 3-hour commercial for
Tony Baloney.
Yeah, for Tony Baloney.
If you brought up the Tonys, Rob, I deleted this because I wasn't going to talk about it, but since you brought it up, Rob freaked out. He was watching the Tonys, and he was like, oh, my God, Sam's on the Tonys.
Watch out, Sam.
Rob, what did you see? What did you see?
What are you talking about?
It was the Pippin did a medley of their songs, and Sam jumped out on stage right in the middle of the song. He started singing, belting some tenor. He had like a whip and a, something, I don't know, something else.
I was on the back porch of my apartment because I wanted to watch. It was a Sunday night, so I was.
Yeah, last Sunday.
We were watching Mad Men, and people came over and took over the television and watched the Tonys. So I was fuming on the porch when they all screamed, Sam, you're on TV. And apparently this very handsome young man was wielding a sword and
obviously
singing
handsome.
About, you know, whatever they sing about in Pippin. I don't know.
And he looked a lot like you?
He was fortunate enough to look a lot like me.
Exactly. He was pretty enough to look like Sam.
This kid is grown up. Plays by his own rules.
No, he's just as awkward as he's always been, folks. He's adorable. Look at him. So you were talking about this earlier. You're a violence director.
There's a lot of names. I try to stick to violence designer. Just because
violence designer.
That makes.
Well, how is that different from a fight choreographer?
Well, it's just the way people perceive it. If you call yourself a fight choreographer, they think, oh, well, we're rehearsing the scene. Let's bring this guy in, and he'll throw something together for us. But if you call yourself a designer, they think, oh, set designer, light designer, sound designer.
Oh, and you're involved in the entire...
Right. Gets you in from the ground level. You get a much more, you know, because there's nothing worse than the phone call saying, well, hey, we're in tech. We need a battle scene for Richard III. Can you come in and just slap together? And as you know from probably Maestro Eric Fredrickson or whoever taught you, it takes some time.
Maestro Eric Fredrickson was the head of the department at U of M where I went to school, certified fight choreographer. He did go by Maestro.
He is one of the original fight masters of the Society.
He is
the Maestro.
He also touches girls in awkward places. So.
Whoa!
I'm just kidding.
You reach a certain point in your life, you know.
Got to do what you got to do. If you're a Maestro, you got to keep that name up.
Do what you got to do. No, he's great. He's a
Are you going to call yourself Maestro, Sam?
Maestro Samuel.
Not without Spiro. Working to the title, I couldn't bestow that upon myself without earning it. I haven't touched enough co-eds yet.
Sure. Keep working.
You're getting there.
That's awesome. Yeah, I don't think we have a lot of that in sort of the Equity Theaters in Michigan because. It would mean paying another designer, which I don't like doing.
Yeah, occasionally, like, David Blix will run around and do something in Michigan. He does the Michigan Shakespeare Festival. But
he does. His wife, Jan Blix, runs the Shakespeare Festival.
Absolutely. They're very nice people.
Have you thought about coming out and doing that?
I auditioned for them a few summers ago, but I'm sort of always in contact with them. I mean, there are just so many 5'10". 20-something skinny white guys who like to speak verse that, you know...
5'10"?
Yeah, I know. He's taller than both of us put together.
on top of each other, right?
Yeah. Growing
stacked
boy.
Up like a big guy, little guy totem pole.
Errol on Chuck's shoulders.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, that's how it's always been.
Atlas shrugged.
Very good.
No, that's awesome. Well, it's funny because I have been shirked by them as well in their auditions, but that's just because they, you know, they have like one or two equity contracts to show and.
Yeah, that's. They
can't afford you earlier.
They can't afford me.
That's rough. Nobody can. When you decide you want to make a living doing it, they can pay one or two people.
Right.
That's right.
Wow, so proud of you, man! You're all grown up. You're
keep it up.
You're doing good, big things in Chicago. You're gonna move out to LA next year.
Make the big money. Come on, out to the coast.
Yeah, I'm making a ton of money over here. But that's great.
Chuck works at a marijuana dispensary.
Hey, there's money in marijuana, okay?
You're
that fact.
Folks like to smoke it, and they like to pay for it.
No, but that's great, and the family's good. Sam?
Yeah. I mean, they are. Eric is, for all of his... you know, merits, he's living at home.
Trying to knock him down a couple notches.
And being a professional athlete.
Hey, do you have a like a fun theater story? Because just because I'm an actor and I'm a dork, do you have any like crazy like this happened during the run? I had to punch a lady because she tried to touch me while I was doing the show or anything.
You know,
the maestro.
The one that comes to mind. I don't have a good Peter O'Toole, Richard Burton. You know, oh, we were drunk and we went on. You know, I don't have. But
you
backstage,
just alienated our entire audience.
Yeah, there you go. All six viewers are Googling frantically trying to find out who
this is. Don't keep it lowbrow, pal.
I was doing the Renaissance Fair. It's hot. You're sweaty. I mean, you're doing 2 or 3 hours of sword fighting a day mixed with a couple other hours of jokes intertwined. We've hit each other in the face and all got scuffed up. But backstage in my eighth grade production of Don Quixote, where I was playing the title role.
Don Quixote, not Man of La Mancha. It was the
no. It was
play,
an adaptation.
Not the musical.
It was an adaptation of the book as the play. And I had white in my hair, and I was washing it off after the show, and I went outside the Lydia Mendelsohn to shake it out of my hair, and someone was holding the door open for me. And as I walked back into the theater, I'm gonna shake it out one more time. And I turned around and shook my head. He then let go of the door, which both all three of you know are two or three
heavy,
thick,
yeah.
you know, wooden
yeah,
doors. Yeah. From, and it swung and hit me right in the skull.
And no.
I grab, you know, swearing like a 14-year-old boy does, and I think it's just bruise. And sweet little Monica Baker, who is about 3 foot nothing and the voice of a cartoon squirrel, asked me if I'm all right, and I said, yeah, I'm fine. She says, can you move your hand? And I distinctly remember removing my hand and watching my vision turn red as blood just poured over and spurted out. And they rushed me right to the hospital after the show,
unfortunately. Oh, my God. Thank God. Thank God the show didn't stop.
Can't let the show stop.
You know what? Show must go on. I don't think should have to apply when you're 14 years old.
Yeah, I think the statute of limitations is yeah.
Right. That's good. My worst story is much less bloody, but slightly more awkward. I was doing a one-man show at the Williamson Theater called Fully Committed. And I was playing like 30.
I saw that.
Did you see that?
You're the restaurant reservation.
I was. 37 different characters. So I was like on the phone with myself. And so you know the show. The chef is loud and obnoxious and right downstage. He screams a lot. There's a lot of screaming in the show. And it was like a matinee show. And there was this old guy who was right in front of the desk where one of the phones were, so you're screaming a lot right into that row. And he was dead asleep, just like passed out. And I, as I was wont to do at the time, I got slightly surly. I was like,
as you should.
What motherfucker is going to sleep during my play? My one-man opus. So I made it even louder. I screamed, like, right in his face. I leaned forward, screamed at him. He didn't move.
Wow.
Snored away. And then there was a waft, a strong smell of human fecal matter.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I've got this guy... who's not moving, smells like shit. I thought he was dead.
Absolutely.
I thought I had killed a man in my show. So we had an intermission. I ran upstairs for intermission. I grabbed my stage manager with as serious as I could be. And I was like, there's a dead man in row one. You get him out of here. You clean the shit, and you get the dead guy out of my show.
Wow, that was
not, you're not concerned about this man and his family. You want to make sure there's not a dead body in your play.
I don't want the dead body ruining my show.
Yeah, that's
right.
It's not. Yeah.
You gotta have priorities.
That was me.
That was Chuck. Chuck wasn't dead. He was just
dead asleep.
I
was just dead asleep.
Yeah, so the guy wasn't asleep. And if you go to the Williamson Theater, you're your goal is to try to not sit in the seat that a guy shit his pants in.
Yeah,
well, man. And you're lucky that you got to scream at him. I mean, because normally, yeah, right? I've been in, I mean, this show right now, there are a lot of old people who want to watch Neil Simon.
Oh, yeah, they love Brighton Beach.
And, you know, God bless him, it's old 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Yeah. It's hard to stay awake, but I'm never in a position to scream at them. Sometimes I'll drop a plate, you know, but like,
oh, right.
Yeah.
I don't know. Good for
cough
you.
Loudly. Yeah, yes. You know. I've had a friend actually like take a cell phone out of someone's hand.
That's yeah. Great. I kind of hope for that moment one day just to
do it. Yeah.
Anyway, so here's where it's going to get awkward, Sam. So, we've known Sam since he was really little, like we said, but we were not so little, and I'd like to think that we've grown up a little, but maybe not.
Not so much. Have you listened to our podcast?
Not so much. So, but Sam was around for a lot of...
like middle school, right? You were in middle school when
well,
we were...
my first memory was I was probably 4 or 5, and then the formative time... with you guys was
yeah his yeah his YAG years and Ann Arbor Pioneer years. He was middle school, high school, and that is when we were quite debaucherous.
We were during that period of time, Errol and I would squat wherever we could in order to be around each other and work together. And there were times
hide from responsibilities in our own lives. Yeah, yeah. And we would squat with Rob. Sometimes Rob would bring us out to Ann Arbor to work on shows, and we would stay at Sam's parents' house, like in their basement.
Yeah, like or if Rob was ever trusted with the responsibility of house sitting,
which was limited. Let's not.
Right. Well, it became limited.
It became limited.
He kept inviting us over, so we would house sit with him. So we put together a little quiz for you, Sam.
Real small. Okay. Real easy.
So this quiz is it's all about what happened in you and your parents' house that you may or may not know about.
The first question is, name an illicit substance that was abused in your home.
Alcohol and probably a whole lot more.
Well,
what's the worst thing that you might have?
What's the worst thing?
Well, I heard you talking earlier, so I'm gonna go with mushrooms.
Good answer. Well, incorrect.
Ah,
crystal meth.
No. No, that's not true.
I was giving you like guys like an 8. You took it to a 10. That's
crystal meth. No, I think it was just probably LSD.
Oh yeah. That did
happen. We won't go into details. All right, second question. Name a location in your home in which Rob had, for unlawful carnal knowledge, with a young woman.
I'm sure in my bedroom.
Or man.
I'm sure in my bedroom, because I think he kind of did the Rob, I'm joking about this, but I'm really serious thing about it to me, you know, like, but I'm going to say it's either that or certainly, you know. The upstairs hall closet, perhaps.
Okay, so we're going with hall closet or Sam's bed.
Yeah, that's what I'm going with.
That's incorrect, Sam. We would have accepted your parents' bed.
Oh, of course.
Or Herbie's crate.
Herbie's kennel.
No!
It was rough, but he did it.
Doggy style.
Hey. Oh, wow!
The first jokes Rob's made since we've started this podcast.
Oh, my gosh.
Good stuff. No, yeah. Okay, what's the last one, Chad?
Herbert was not a large dog. Let's remind ourselves.
Well, Rob's not a large man. Rob is not a large man.
Herbie. Last one. What item went missing while we were house-sitting?
Yes.
Once.
What item went missing? I couldn't tell you. I got nothing. You steal like the toaster? It's got to be more ridiculous than that. What do you do?
There was a story of maybe your an item of your father's that disappeared. Sports equipment.
like his golf clubs, like a baseball glove.
What there did you go. Ding 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 ding. That is correct. The family golf clubs.
The golf clubs went missing, but
that and the family car.
Yeah, we lost the car at one point. We had to run around town to find it.
No, we did lose Herbie at one point though.
Wait, the clubs?
Rob, you don't remember this?
What? No, I don't remember the clubs going missing.
What went missing?
I remember a tennis racket.
Oh, the tennis racket.
Wow, we can't even get our own story straight here.
We don't even know.
We were on so many drugs at your house.
You were not in a position, obviously, yeah, to put it all together.
Oh, man.
If anything went missing, we just blamed it on Zach. That was what we were like. You know what? Zach had a few people over.
The problem is Zach always blamed it on us. So it was this, like, cycle. So we also wanted you to know, do you have a memory of Chuck Anchori coming home?
Oh.
What was it? Coming home early one morning, right, during breakfast?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
where he just sort of showed up and no one else was at our home? Is it one of those?
Oh, no.
No. Like, we did that often as well.
We did do that. We're like,
Rob and I were there.
It was when we were staying in your basement for a couple of months, and I remember one day or one night after like rehearsals or something, I ended up crashing at a female friend's place.
How old is she?
On campus. That is an important question, isn't it? Yeah. She was in college-aged woman.
Oh, hey, all's fair.
And I remember coming back to the house like really early in the morning, and the whole family, including Rob and Errol, was eating breakfast. And I walked in like all disheveled, like the
morning after.
Morning at like worst influence.
Yeah.
Oh God, that was embarrassing.
Oh, clearly you didn't remember, so you're fine. You're fine.
Thank God.
Well, yeah, that was the only memory that would have given me any sort of wrong ideas. That was it. Remember you all waking Eric and I up to celebrate Festivus at about 5 in the morning one year.
That's some fun.
Yeah, that's funny because we were coming home at 5 a.m.
Exactly.
You
woke
up early. Yeah. Good stuff. Those years
now as a 22-year-old and actually be able to identify what you all were on at each time would be a
What are you talking about? Clean living.
Yeah, users are losers.
Come on, kids.
High on life.
Exactly. So, we were high on theater at that time.
Right.
Well, but I am glad that we did. I don't even know if we were the influence, but I'm glad we were able to help keep you on that path, because it seems like you're doing very well, Samuel.
I am trying, and you certainly didn't hurt at all. Thanks, you definitely pushed me further.
So thank you so much for being on our show.
Yeah, dude. Thanks for coming on here.
Happy to be on. I hope you can edit something of that together to make it look
good. I doubt it. So you can catch Sam at the Raven Theater, is that right?
At Raven Theater?
Raven Theater until, give us the info again.
July 14th. We run this Thursday through Sunday, and then after that we just do Friday, Saturday, Sundays. And Uncle Bob is at Mariachi Theater till July 21st.
Awesome. If our listeners want to leave a comment, if you're in the Chicago area, Sam can't get you free tickets, but
absolutely,
I'm going to make him give you a personal VIP backstage tour.
Absolutely.
So go see Brighton Beach Memoirs, and Sam will show you his package.
He'll give you an autograph.
On the package.
Sam, thanks for coming on the show. Appreciate
you.
You're awesome. You're totally awesome.
Right. Thank you for, I don't know. I was going to say something mean to Rob, and I stopped.
Well, that's good.
Thank you.
Audience, you can like us on Facebook at facebook.com/WestXMidwest. You can follow and tweet your comments, questions on Twitter at West_X_Midwest. Email us any questions or comments at WestXMidwestPodcast@gmail.com. You can watch this show with Sam Hubbard on our YouTube channel. Just search out WestXMidwest on YouTube. And subscribe, stream, download, write a review on iTunes, West by Midwest. Thank you so much for listening, ladies and gentlemen.
And we will see you Suckers next week.
Next week, hopefully I'll be alive. I got to run a half marathon this Sunday, and hopefully I will still survive that.
Good luck with that. You've been training and stuff, yeah?
Yeah. Pasadena half marathon this Sunday, so come out.
If you have any advice for Chuck, throw it up on Facebook. We're going to give updates of his training.
Training's over, man. It's just time to run it.
Time to carbo load and go.
Eat that pasta, get some gels, and run.
So thanks, everybody, for listening, and we will see you idiots next week.
That's right. I'm Chuck Anchori.
I'm Errol Gribble. On behalf of Robert Hubbard, this has been...
West
by Midwest.
See you next week.